Hypertension is a state when during patient examination in the office, his systolic blood pressure is higher than 140 and diastolic is higher than 90. Nowadays, to classify the severity of hypertension, we use grades. And from grade 1 hypertension, person should receive antihypertensive treatment. To explain the logic behind antihypertensive drugs, we have to recall normal physiology. So here we have blood vessel, and inside the blood vessels we have blood. Blood is a fluid, and as any fluid, blood has hydrostatic pressure. And we know that hydrostatic pressure acts in all directions, including the blood vessel wall. And exactly hydrostatic pressure that acts on blood vessel wall we measure during the standard blood pressure examination. But which factors determine hydrostatic pressure? Recall that hydrostatic pressure is directly proportional to fluid density times fluid volume times gravity constant, and inversely proportional to the area on which hydrostatic pressure acts. And from these four factors, fluid volume is the most important. The concept here is that the bigger the volume of fluid inside the blood vessel, the bigger the hydrostatic pressure, and thereby the higher will be the blood pressure. The factor that determines how much fluid will income to the blood vessel is cardiac output. Cardiac output is the volume of blood that heart pumps per minute. So basically, cardiac output is equal to heart rate times stroke volume. With heart rate, everything is clear. But what is stroke volume? Stroke volume is the volume of blood that heart pumps per one contraction. So, the major factor that determines stroke volume is the total volume of fluid in the general circulation. And the major organ that regulates the volume of blood in the general circulation are kidneys, because kidneys provide reabsorption of fluid. So, there are two major organs that determine blood pressure. It's kidneys and heart. But there is also additional factor that determines blood pressure, and it's resistance of the blood vessels. The major factor that determines resistance is radius of the blood vessel. Basically, the more contracted is the blood vessel, the smaller is the radius, and thereby the higher is the resistance. And the higher the resistance, the greater is the pressure on blood vessel wall, and thereby the higher will be blood pressure that we measure. Because of huge importance of the blood vessel resistance and kidney reabsorption, these two factors should be under strict regulation. And the factor that regulates the state of the blood vessels and the reabsorption of fluid by the kidneys is renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system. The key element in this system is angiotensin II receptor. The substance that activates this receptor called angiotensin II. Exactly, activation of angiotensin II receptor by angiotensin II stimulates reabsorption of fluid by the kidneys and contraction of the blood vessels. And as we can see, the consequence of angiotensin receptor activation is increase in blood pressure. But angiotensin II itself is just the final product of several reactions. First of all, we make angiotensin II from angiotensin I, and enzyme that provides this conversion called angiotensin-converting enzyme. In turn, angiotensin I is produced from angiotensinogen, and enzyme that provides this conversion called renin. So, as we see, there are several factors that are required to activate angiotensin II receptor, which in turn will provide increase in blood pressure. So, to summarize, blood pressure is determined by two factors. It's cardiac output and blood vessels resistance. And cardiac output is determined by stroke volume and heart rate. According to current guidelines, we have five major drug classes that are recommended for treatment of hypertension. It's thiazide diuretics, beta blockers, calcium channel blockers, ACE inhibitors, and angiotensin receptor blockers. The most popular medication for hypertension are blockers of renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system. It's ACE inhibitors and angiotensin receptor blockers. We prescribe one of these drugs for every patient with hypertension. So let's explain the mechanism of these drugs. ACE inhibitors block the function of angiotensin-converting enzyme. With blockage of ACE enzyme, the production of angiotensin II decreases. As a result, the activation of angiotensin II receptor decreases. In contrast to ACE inhibitors, angiotensin receptor blockers block angiotensin II receptor directly. With decreasing activation of angiotensin II receptor, first of all, fluid reabsorption by the kidneys decreases, which will cause decreasing stroke volume. With decreasing stroke volume, cardiac output decreases, and thereby hydrostatic pressure that acts on blood vessel wall decreases. So, as we see, ACE inhibitors and ARBs cause decreasing stroke volume, that cause decreasing cardiac output, which results in decreasing blood pressure. But in addition to this, with decreasing activation of angiotensin II receptor, vasoconstriction decreases. So vessels will become more delayed. With increasing radius of the vessel, blood vessel resistance decreases. And the lower is the blood vessel resistance, the lower is the blood pressure. So with decreasing vasoconstriction, blood pressure decreases. Among all antihypertensive drugs, angiotensin receptor blockers are considered the safest agents. Important that we have to choose only one of these two drugs, because they should not be combined. Usually, we begin with ACE inhibitors, and if patient will have cough, and cough can be a side effect of ACE inhibitors, in this case, as a reserve option, we use ARBs. ACE inhibitors and ARBs are also considered the most effective antihypertensive agents for renal protection, especially in cases when chronic kidney disease is caused by diabetes. In addition to this, ACE inhibitors and ARBs could prevent hypertension-mediated organ damage, which is an extremely valuable feature, especially in patients with severe hypertension. We have to know that both ACE inhibitors and ARBs are contraindicated during pregnancy due to the teratogenic effect. Also, because both these drugs cause increase in blood potassium level, they are contraindicated in case of hyperkalemia. And the last contraindication is bilateral renal artery stenosis. So we should be very careful with these two agents in women of childbearing potential, simply because these drugs potentially can cause harm to fetus. The next class of antihypertensive drugs are calcium channel blockers. Calcium channel blockers are very popular agents. We have to know that calcium channel blockers are subdivided on two classes. It's peripheral calcium channel blockers, we call them dihydropyridines, and central calcium channel blockers, it's verapamil and diltiazem. The easy way to remember them is phrase VDDPins, where V stands for verapamil, D for diltiazem, and DPins stands for peripheral calcium channel blockers. The major effect of central calcium channel blockers and its verapamil and diltiazem is decreasing heart rate. With decreasing heart rate, cardiac output decreases. With decreasing cardiac output, the income of blood to the vessel decreases. And the lower is the volume of blood inside the vessel, the lower is the hydrostatic pressure. And the lower is the hydrostatic pressure, the lower is the blood pressure. So, central calcium channel blockers, by decreasing heart rate, cause decreasing cardiac output, which results in decreasing blood pressure. The major effect of peripheral calcium channel blockers, so-called DPINs, is relaxation of peripheral blood vessels. With relaxation of the blood vessels, radius of the blood vessels increase and thereby resistance decrease. And the lower is the resistance, the lower is the blood pressure. So, peripheral calcium channel blockers cause decrease in peripheral resistance, which results in decrease in blood pressure. But peripheral calcium channel blockers have one significant side effect. Initially, abrupt decrease in peripheral resistance will cause abrupt decrease in blood pressure. And organism naturally tries to maintain blood pressure at a steady level. So, as in compensatory reaction, organism induce increase in heart rate, which will cause increase in cardiac output, and increase in cardiac output will cause increase in blood pressure. So, the side effect of peripheral calcium channel blockers is the reflex tachycardia. So, because the major effect of central calcium channel blockers is decrease in heart rate, we do not prescribe them for patients with high-grade heart blocks. Also, we do not prescribe them for patients with severe left ventricular dysfunction. And obviously, we avoid them in patients with bradycardia. Also, we should know that verapamil and diltiazem can cause constipation. Peripheral calcium channel blockers have two major side effects. As we already said, it's tachycardia and also it's severe lacedema. The next class of antihypertensive agents is beta blockers. The major effect of beta blockers is decrease in heart rate. With decrease in heart rate, cardiac output decreases. And the lower the cardiac output, the lower volume of blood will income to the blood vessel, and thereby the lower will be the hydrostatic pressure. And the lower the hydrostatic pressure, the lower the blood pressure. So beta blockers, by decreasing heart rate, cause decreasing cardiac output, which results in decreasing blood pressure. Beta blockers, in most aspects, have the same efficiency as other antihypertensive drugs, but they are less effective in prevention of strokes. Also, beta blockers are less effective in prevention of left ventricular hypertrophy, aortic stiffness, and small artery remodeling. And it's the reason why in most cases we prefer calcium channel blockers, and beta blockers serves as a reserve option. Another problem is that beta blockers, in combination with diuretics, significantly increase the risk of new-onset diabetes, especially in patients with metabolic syndrome who are already predisposed to diabetes. And last but not least, blockage of beta receptors can cause constriction of airways, which can be a problem in patients with asthma. So, beta blockers are contraindicated in patients with asthma and in patients with high-grade heart blocks. Also, we should be very careful with beta blockers in patients with metabolic syndrome and glucose intolerance, because beta blockers increase the risk of diabetes. And if person is physically active, beta blockers are not the best choice. And the last group of antihypertensive drugs are diuretics. For hypertension, we use thiazides and thiazide-like diuretics. To thiazide-like diuretics belong clortalidone and indapamide. To classic thiazide diuretics belong clortiazide and pendrafluorazide. Thiazide diuretics inhibit kidney reabsorption. With decrease in fluid reabsorption, the total volume of fluid in the general circulation decreases. This will cause decrease in stroke volume, and with decrease in stroke volume, cardiac output decreases, which will cause decrease in amount of fluid that incomes to the blood vessel. And the lower is the amount of fluid in the blood vessel, the lower is the hydrostatic pressure, and thereby the lower will be the blood pressure. So, thiazide diuretics cause decrease in stroke volume, this cause decrease in cardiac output, and as a result, blood pressure will decrease. For hypertension, there is no significant clinical difference between thiazide diuretics. But we have to know that thiazide diuretics cause decrease in uric acid excretion. So, thiazide diuretics cause increase in uric acid level in the blood. And recall that the major pathology that is associated with high uric acid level is gout. So, thiazide diuretics are contraindicated in patients with gout. Here we can see a classical approach to treatment of hypertension. Initially, we prescribe one of the renin angiotensin aldosterone system inhibitors, usually its ACE inhibitor. And in addition to ACE inhibitor, we prescribe calcium channel blocker or thiazide diuretic. If these do not help, we prescribe ACE inhibitor or ARB blocker with calcium channel blocker and diuretic. And if hypertension is resistant, we add additional agents. Usually, we add spironolactone, which is potassium-sparing diuretic, or alpha blocker or beta blocker.